Hello, this is Athena Lemon from the Wolbachia Project, and today we're talking about Lab 3, Polymerase Chain Reaction, or PCR. PCR is a really common molecular biology technique where you can amplify DNA. If you have one copy of DNA, after PCR, you can have over a billion copies. But you have to know exactly what fragment you want to amplify. So how do we know which fragment we want to amplify? For this project, we'll be amplifying part of an arthropod barcoding gene and a gene that's specific to Wolbachia. It's pretty cool that you can read DNA and know exactly what organism it belongs to. That's the process of barcoding. So how are we going to barcode our arthropods, for example? This is a fragment of the cytochrome oxidase 1 gene. All arthropods have this gene, and most of it is exactly the same. That's called the conserved region, where it's the same for almost every arthropod. However, this is the cool part, there's also a fragment of this gene that is different in every single arthropod. So we can barcode this part, the variable part, by looking and starting our search at the conserved region because we know what that sequence is, and copying across that variable region until we get to what we know the sequence is again at the other side of the conserved region. So how do we amplify just this region? We use primers. Primers are about 20 base pairs long, and they're fragments of DNA that I like to think of as the control find of PCR. They're long enough that they're unique and will only bind in one location. A's bind to T's, C's bind to G's, and vice versa. We'll add primers at the beginning and end of this fragment so that we capture this entire area. These are called forward and reverse primers. Then a special DNA polymerase that can withstand really high temperatures will bind to these primers and replicate the DNA across the entire region, adding new nucleotides. That's the general idea for one copy, but what about multiple copies? How do we amplify this exponentially? That's the beauty of PCR. PCR uses heat to control the replication process so that one copy of DNA can become a billion copies of DNA. First, our PCR reaction is heated up to 94 degrees Celsius. This is the denaturation temperature, or the temperature where the DNA separates from a double strand into two single strands. Then we'll cool our entire reaction off to the annealing temperature. The annealing temperature is where primers bind or sit down on the DNA. That annealing temperature is specific to the primers that you have. Then we'll heat our mixture back up again to extension, where that special TAC polymerase is able to replicate the DNA and bring it from two single-strand copies to two double-strand copies. The process then repeats all over again, with the cycle repeating and going back up to 94 degrees Celsius for denaturation, annealing, and extension. We'll repeat that whole process 30 times, and that's how you can amplify to over a billion copies. 94 degrees Celsius is really hot. It's almost boiling. There's no DNA polymerase in your body that would be able to work at that temperature. So instead, we're going to use a DNA polymerase that was discovered from the hot springs at Yellowstone National Park. This DNA polymerase was discovered from the bacteria Thermus aquaticus. And this heat-stable DNA polymerase extracted from it has now just been shortened to TAC polymerase. So we know we need DNA, specific primers, and TAC polymerase for our PCR reaction to work. We also need a buffer that's optimized for the TAC polymerase and extra bases so the TAC polymerase can create a new strand of DNA. The extra bases, buffer, and TAC polymerase are normally all sold together in what's called the TAC master mix. And once we add that TAC master mix to our primers, DNA, and some DNA-free water to bring up the volume, then we're ready to start our PCR. I want to take a second and talk about the DNA-free water. It's really important that it's DNA-free. We don't want to amplify anything else than what we're trying to amplify. When you're using specific primers, every single PCR reaction will be exactly the same, except for the DNA. But we don't want to add every single ingredient to each tiny PCR tube, so instead, we'll make a PCR cocktail. A cocktail has the TAC master mix, the primers you're using, and the DNA-free water to bring it up to a volume. To calculate how much goes into this PCR cocktail, we want to take the number of the samples that we have, plus one. That accounts for pipetting error. So for example, if I had six samples and I was going to add forward primer to my PCR cocktail, and I knew that there were 3.2 microliters in an original, just one reaction, I would take 3.2 times 6 plus 1 is 7, and I would add 22.4 microliters of forward primer into my PCR cocktail. When I'm done making my cocktail, I then aliquot and move exactly the amount of liquid I need to the DNA in my PCR tube, and that's a lot easier and more accurate than adding every single ingredient to the tube. Once you've put your tubes in the thermocycler and you're done with your PCR, you can update your database post to reflect if you ran a duplex PCR, which is running the arthropod primers and the Wolbachia primers in the same reaction, or single PCR, which is running the arthropod primers and the Wolbachia primers in different reactions. We actually recommend this because there's a different annealing temperature for the Wolbachia primers versus the arthropod primers. And you'll probably get better results if you run them separately. The next lab is finally visualizing your DNA. And I'll see you there for lab 4, gel electrophoresis.